Good evening, everyone. We'll begin the festivities tonight. My name is Paul O'Neill, and on behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, I'd like to welcome you to tonight's presentation of our monthly lecture series, and the subject of which couldn't be closer to home, the Senate House. In fact, the title for tonight's presentation is The Senate House, Cradle of the... Thank you, Hugh. No, it's the Senate House, Cradle of Democracy. And the Senate House has certainly been the cradle for our lecture series. Quite frankly, we wouldn't be here tonight without them. But the Senate House has been one of the focal points of our history from the very beginning. Located within the original portion of the stockade as laid out by Peter Stuyvesant in 1658, the Senate House has been the home for some of our most celebrated denizens. Our history has been written within its walls. And we're most fortunate tonight to have as our presenters two of the people who make this place, which is the oldest public building in the United States, such a special place. So I would ask you to give a warm welcome to the people who welcome us so warmly month after month, Deana Preston and Tom Kernan.
Thank you. As Paul said, I'm Deana. I've been working here at Senate House for almost 16 years, and I'm not from the area originally. And one of the things that has struck me over the years that I've lived and worked in Kingston is how passionate Kingston is about its history. And I think Senate House is just one example of how excited people are. Just talking to some of you this evening about the long time that these lectures have been going on and the exhibits in the museum. So I hope you'll enjoy tonight's presentation. I'm going to talk about the building of the house up to New York State purchase of the house in the 1880s. And as Paul said, Senate House has been called the oldest public building in America. One of the last private owners to live in the house actually was the very first person to call it the oldest public building in America. And it was always a private home. Even when the senators were meeting here, it was still a private home owned and occupied by Abraham Van Gaspeek. But I think its primary function was as a family home. The senators met here, they only were here for about a month, but certainly what they did was groundbreaking and certainly a strike for the freedom of the country. But it started out, as I said, as a family home. Thomas Chambers, as you know, was the first person who got credit for establishing Kingston. He was living in the colony of Rensselaerswyck, which is present-day Albany and Rensselaer counties, and he didn't like all the rules and regulations that were up there. Excuse me. So he and some of his cronies decided to come down. They actually purchased land from the Native Americans, and they were living on scattered farms all around, and the relationship between the colonists and the Esopus Indians was not the greatest. There was a lot of tension. The colonists were told, don't trade guns and alcohol to the Native Americans. But the profit was too great, so a lot of people, including Thomas Chambers, ignored that and sold guns and alcohol to the Native Americans. But eventually, they finally said to Governor Stuyvesant, you've got to do something. And he said, well, you have a choice. When there's trouble with the Native Americans here, you can go up to Albany, you can go down to New York, or you can build yourself a stockade. 3 weeks later, they had themselves a stockade. It wasn't very large, and it was expanded a few times. And in 1676, Wessel Ten Broeck built a house on the northeast corner of the stockade. It was the Senate House. It looked completely different from the image on the screen that you see. More than likely, it was wooden, with the gable end facing the street, which is present-day Clinton Avenue. And the front part that everyone saw as they went by was probably brick. The rest of the house was wooden. No one saw that part. Everybody walking by the house would see that it was brick, think, wow, these people are doing pretty good. They can afford to build a brick home. And so it took probably another 70 years before the house became reconstructed in the stone. But originally it was a one-room house that Wessel Ten Broeck built. He and his wife had 11 children, 8 survived to adulthood. And it was their family home. It was built in 3 different levels. Make sure I do this right. It was built in 3 different levels, which was very traditional for the Dutch. Okay. The original part of the house is right here. It's marked B1 on this. I don't know how well y'all can see it, but it's marked B1. This is actually the basement plan. So the house was built in three different levels. The ground floor level was used for day-to-day living. The kitchen more than likely was located in the basement, and we do have a kitchen or a fireplace in the basement. And the second floor was probably more than likely a half of a floor where an adult might not be able to stand up straight, but it was used for additional sleeping and storage space, so that really didn't matter. And it served very comfortably as a stone as a family home for Wessel Ten Broeck. And when he passed away, the house went to one of his sons, Wessel Ten Broeck Jr. And when he died, the house went to his brother, Johannes. And Johannes ended up buying out all his brothers and sisters' portion in the house. So Johannes is the one, around 1730, made some additions and changes to the house. So by 1730, he had the house with this original portion, and then he added on this wing to the north, and probably built a detached kitchen in the rear of it. So effectively, he doubled the size of the house. Originally, the house was about 20 by 25 feet. And so Johannes added this on this section here and the original kitchen. He had the money to do it. Slightly larger family. You could spread out and have specialized rooms for specialized tasks where you necessarily would not want to entertain in the kitchen area or in a sleeping area. You now had another room where you could perhaps use it for entertainment, for business purposes. Johannes's daughter, Sarah Ten Broeck, married a gentleman by the name of Abraham Van Gaspeek. And it's actually through Sarah that Abraham Van Gaspeek comes to live in the house. And I want to take some time and talk about the Van Gaspeek family, because they really had a long history, and a very important history, not just in the house, but in Kingston as well. When Thomas Chambers died in 1694, he left his estate, Foxhole Manor, he left the manor house, and he left his mills to his stepson, Abraham Van Gaspeek, on the condition that Abraham take the name Chambers, because when Thomas Chambers married the widow Van Gaspeek, they did not have children of their own. He just had stepchildren. So he made a condition that Abraham Van Gaspeek had to take the name of Chambers in order to get his stepfather's estate. So Abraham took the name of Chambers. We don't know how long he kept it, but eventually he did drop it away. And he's Abraham Van Gaspeek Chambers. Now there's a couple generations of Abraham Van Gaspeek, so I'm just gonna call him Abraham Chambers. And Abraham Chambers had several brothers and sisters, and they took over the property that their stepfather had. And they had a tradition of growing wheat on family-owned farms, milling it in family-owned grist mills, and sending it down to New York City on family-owned sloops, so all the money would stay in the family. They realized that if it was broken up between Abraham Chambers and his five brothers and three sisters, that chances are the family would not be as well off financially as they eventually did become. Abraham Chambers and his brothers, among them, the five of them, owned 14 slaves. Now, there were people in town who had more slaves, there were people in town who had fewer slaves, but most people in town did not have slaves. So having slaves in the family, and we think Abraham probably had about five in his own household, was an indication of how well he was doing on his farm. His Abraham Chambers' son was Abraham, and I call him our Abraham because our Abraham is the one who rented the house out to the senators. So Abraham Chambers, the father, was a justice of the peace in Kingston. He was able to hear criminal and civil court cases that occurred on the Foxhall Manor estate. He was also an officer in the county militia. So he held a prominent position financially, militarily, and politically. And that tradition certainly passed on to his son, R. Abraham. R. Abraham was trained as a sloop captain. And it was he that would take the ground flour down to New York City. It was destined for the West Indies and Europe. And he would also take orders from local Kingston residents who couldn't get goods from New York City unless they went through Abraham. They couldn't get it very easily on their own here in Kingston. So they went to Abraham and said, look, I hear you're going to New York. Can you get me the following list? And he said, sure. So he started that. And excuse me. And eventually, our Abraham married a woman by the name of Sarah. And they had three children. Only one survived to complete adulthood. And we're not really sure when Abraham and Sarah started to live in Senate House. We think they were there by the 1750s because Abraham added this space onto the house to the south. This is the actual room that the senators ended up renting. But for now, it's just the south room. So by the time Abraham was living here in the 1760s, the house consisted of this room, this room, this room, and the detached kitchen. So it was quite a substantial house. And I've often thought over the years that Wessel Ten Broeck probably would have no recognition of the house, because when he built it, it was just this space right here. But Abraham Van Gaspy, yes, there have been changes that have been made to it, and Tom will talk a little bit more about that. But it's the same footprint from about the 1770s, which is our real important date. And I think Abraham, our Abraham, would probably have a fairly good idea of the layout of the house. But our Abraham, as I said, was trained as a sloop captain. So when he brought the goods up to Kingston, we think this room was added on to be used as his store. If you've ever been on a tour of Senate House, it has a separate entrance right here. We take visitors in through here. There's a door here, and there's also a door here. And when the tour's over, we let visitors out of the building at this space here. But having a separate door was very practical because it separated the private living space, this part of the house, from the more commercial space, this part of the house. There is also a staircase that's been blocked off. It's very narrow, but it's a staircase that goes up and down. So if anybody had to get supplies from the basement or from the attic, they could use the staircase here. So there was a beginning of the separation of your work life from your private life. And you can start to see that with how our Abraham ended up using that south room. Now, our Abraham was also involved in politics, and he was also involved in education. He was one of the trustees of the Kingston Academy. He was a justice of the peace. He was a juror. So again, he could hear cases and make rulings on cases. And we think at the time of his death in 1794, he may have owned at least one slave, maybe two slaves. His will does indicate, I think there's at least two slaves, a man and a woman, that he had in his will. Excuse me. Now, one of the things that our Abraham did was he was a member of the Board of Trustees, which was the governing body for Kingston. And as such, he played a role long before he rented the room out to the senators for the meeting place of the first senators. The Board of Trustees supported the Continental Congress's boycott of the English goods and the tea in the 1770s. And they also supported the Article of Association, which was signed to support the New York Provincial Congress as the leading governing body of the colony of New York. So Abraham always felt that there was an opportunity to break away from England and to support the formation of a new New York state government. When Abraham's son Peter became an adult, he joined the army. And he spent a great deal of time over across the river. And a lot of the letters that we have between Abraham and Peter talk about business, but they also talk about some politics and things that are going on. And Abraham felt very strongly that he was a New York State resident, and that New York State certainly had a right to govern itself in a free manner. So by the time he actually rented the room out to the senators, he already had established a pattern of supporting the freedom of not just New York, but the whole United States as well. By the 1770s, Abraham was not taking a very active part in going to New York on the sloop any longer. He actually hired a sloop captain. He may have even trained one of his slaves to be the sloop captain. And he was asking his son Peter to act as his agent in New York. Abraham's wife Sarah was not well. She actually died in 1775 or 1776. And in many of the letters that we have between Abraham and Peter, as I said, they talk about the business, but they also talk about Sarah's health. Peter, in every letter we have, Peter always inquires after, how's mother feeling? Is mother feeling better? Give her my love. And Abraham would write back, your mother's feeling better. She was actually able to sit up in bed for a little while today. She went downstairs today. Or in a couple of them, your mother's not doing so well. She was very much taken with a fever and a pain in her head. And then there were the other little things that make the letter so much fun to read. Abraham would write to Peter, your mother wants to know, did you get the basket with the sausages and the warm socks? If you have any mending or laundry to do, bring it home. Your mother will take care of it when you come home. We look forward to seeing you. We send you our love. There's a lot of affection in the family. And after Sarah passed away, Abraham also lost his daughter and granddaughter. His daughter died in childbirth, and the child died 1 month later. So Abraham was effectively by himself, and more than likely was probably living in this end of the house. It's a large room. It's got, obviously, a fireplace. It would have been very comfortable and very easy to stock it with firewood. So the senators are looking for a room to rent. They were meeting down in Fishkill before they came here. They basically came to Kingston because Kingston had enough lodging for everyone. They did not stay in the Senate House. They found lodging elsewhere in the city. They met here. Abraham was a smart businessman. He actually charged the senators a fee. We don't know how much it is. I'd love to find out how much it cost them to rent here. But we do know they grumbled and groaned and said it was too expensive. So they haggled back and forth with Abraham, and they finally settled on a satisfactory price. But as I said, we don't know what that price is. The closest thing we have to indicate the payment was that there was a letter saying, please pay Abraham Van Gaspik for the rent of his home. They met here starting in September 9th, 1777. They wanted to start meeting earlier in the year. They started coming in the summer, but they never had a quorum until September. They met here for a month, and then they got word that Fort Clinton at Montgomery had fallen to the British forces in early October. And when that news finally hit Kingston, everybody in town realized we are literally next in the line of fire. So everybody left town. Abraham left town. The senators left town. Everybody fled. When the British came up and burned Kingston, Senate House was also burned. We're not really sure how bad the damage was. We figure by that time the original pantile roof was long gone, and it was probably wooden shingles by 1777, so that was probably destroyed. And then the rest of the damage was confined to the interior of the house. And if you go into the house today, you can look around, and the floorboards are very, very wide, and there was some dendrochronology done in the 1970s that indicated the wood probably came from the 1780s, definitely after the burning of Kingston. So it was thought that perhaps somebody had a stockpile of wood, and after the house was burned, hey, we have some wood, do you need it? There was a lot of neighborly helping and sharing after the burning, and we figured that might account for some of the wood being after the burning of Kingston. Excuse me. Our Abraham died in 1794. Peter survived his father by just 3 years. He was married by that time. When our Abraham died, he left the house not to Peter. Peter was not a great businessman. He left the house to his niece, Sarah, who ended up marrying Peter. So Peter got the house anyway. We have a wonderful group of two letters written to Peter in the 1790s, and he owed money to everybody. And one of his creditors wrote a letter, and it said very nicely, your payment is due, please send to me as soon as you can. And that was in November of 1 year. The following March, there's another letter that said, for God's sake, man, pay me the money that you owe me. And I just love those two letters back to back. So Peter was not a good businessman. Peter and Sarah had one daughter. Her name was Sarah, and she was only 6 months old when her father died. So after Peter died, Sarah and daughter Sarah were living in the house. Now we know in the 1790s, as late 1790s, early 1800s, the house was rented out for a variety of reasons. It was rented out to a gentleman, and his name escapes me right at this second, who became the minister, a minister to France, and he put the first marble fireplace in Kingston over in the Senate House. It was also in the 1820s, I believe, there was an advertisement in one of the local newspapers for a woman's school at the, or a girl's school at the Van Gaspeek house. And it was just for girls. They were taught chemistry, biology, reading, writing, rhetoric, painting, and sewing. Sarah and her daughter Sarah left the house for a while. We don't know why, but probably by the 1830s, 1840s, they came back. Sarah, the mother, had passed away, so daughter Sarah was living in the house. And she had no brothers and sisters. She had some cousins. And when she passed away, she left the house to her cousin, Charles Ruggles Westbrook. And when he passed, he gave it to his half-brother, Frederick Edward Westbrook. And he was a lawyer in New York City and planned on and ended up using the house strictly as a summer house. We know he had some changes made to the doors and the windows and the interior walls. He made it more comfortable for himself for use as just strictly a summer house. And it was he that actually coined the phrase, Senate House is the oldest public building in America. And it really wasn't until, oh, around this time, because when he died, he gave it to his sister, Elizabeth, who was married to Marius Schoonmaker. And they're the ones that ended up selling it to New York State. But Frederick Edward Westbrook really saved the house, I think, to a certain degree, because around this time when he had the house, and he wrote a booklet in 1877, I believe, it talked about a lot of the historic events that happened, not just at Senate House, but in Kingston as a whole. And it's a wonderful read. But he also talks about the historic preservation movement. The Mount Vernon Ladies Association had stepped in and was saving George Washington's home from falling apart. And so Senate House really kind of rode on the coattails of that organization, and people were realizing how important it was to save the buildings that were associated with really important events in our early nation's history. And if it weren't for Frederick Edward Westbrook, I don't know if Senate House would have been in such excellent condition when New York State purchased it, because he really did a lot to save the building. It wasn't until much later that it was known as the old Senate House. When he had it, it was my family home, because everybody who's lived in the house from the time Wessel Ten Broeck built it in 1676 until New York State purchased it in 1887 could trace their family back to Wessel Ten Broeck. Not always in a direct line, but always back to Wessel Ten Broeck. So that's another great testament to how much people love Kingston and don't want to move away because it's such a great place to live. Tom?
Okay, well, Deana just explained the early part of the history of Senate House, and I'm going to pick it up from state acquisition up to today. And before I left my home this morning, I said to my wife, or reminded her, I have to do a program tonight, and she reminded me, well, don't be winded. So I guarantee, got my phone here so I can keep trying. After 27 years of presenting programs, I've learned three things to being a good presenter: be accurate, be brief, and be gone. So. Okay. There we go. Okay, this is what Senate House looked like when the state bought it from Marius and Elizabeth Schoonmaker. The state purchased it on October 29th, 1887. It was purchased for a figure of $8,000, which the state actually budgeted up to $10,000 to purchase the home. New York State architect Isaac G. Perry accepted the deed for the house, and changes were made immediately. Perry made a study and offered recommendations for improvement. His plan was to make it appear as it did when the Senate met here, which was the historic preservation philosophy of that period. The philosophy of historic preservation has changed tremendously, especially since the 1970s. Prior to the 1970s, even through the 60s, the philosophy was, when you acquire a house, let's make it look like the time period you're interpreting, whether it actually looked like that or not. Thought comes to mind, before coming here, I worked at another state historic site called Herkimer Home State Historic Site in the Mohawk Valley. And their restoration period was between 1960 and 1967. People in the museum field recognize the Cooperstown Graduate Program for Museum Studies as being the first and most famous of the museum programs in the country. They were established back in 1964. And I was talking with a guy who was one of the early graduates of that program back in the 60s. And he told me that one of his professors would actually take the class over to Herkimer Home to show them what not to do in historic preservation, because they completely gutted it without regard to the historic fabric, the walls, the ceilings, the woodworking, and put it back as they saw it should be for a home in 1777. So that was really the philosophy at the time. So you see many changes that have happened to Senate House and other historic sites like Herkimer Home that New York State owned. I just want to read an article, just a short paragraph that appeared in the Daily Freeman back on February 12, 1887, before the state actually purchased the house, but they're talking about changing it for the better. And the article says, Isaac G. Perry, the commissioner of the new capitol at Albany and supervising architect of the state's buildings, was in Kingston yesterday examining the historic Senate House on Clinton Avenue. Mr. Perry made a very thorough examination of the building, measuring every room and preparing a diagram of the house. The house will be changed externally to a considerable extent, every change being in the way of restoration so as to make it appear as it did when the Senate met here. The roof will be reshingled with old-fashioned broad shingles and will be extended over the eaves. The modern cornices will be removed and all wooden additions taken away. The modern chimneys will be rebuilt of stone and the exterior of the house will be otherwise greatly improved. So making those changements back in 1887 were seen as an improvement. Today, it's probably on completely opposite ends of the spectrum, what is proper historic preservation of a house like Senate House. But many restorations or changes were made to the Senate House. There was actually two periods, restoration periods. The one post-1887, right after New York State took over the property, and then the 1948 to 1962 restoration period, which was even more extensive, especially on the interior of the house. You see this section here, this was removed shortly after 1887 by New York State. And in its place, this was built, which we recognize today as part of the Senate House. The reason for this is that if the Senate House was going to be a public building open to the public, there needed to be room for a caretaker to live in. So this addition that was added after 1887 was living space for the schoonmakers, who were the first caretakers of Senate House. Another change that was made to the exterior of the Senate House . You see this porch here on the south side. This was removed, and also you'll notice clapboard all along here on the gable ends and where the dormers are had wood clapboard on it, and that was all removed as well. Another addition that was made to it, this area here is the kitchen. So this was built by New York State along with the area for the caretaker to live in. back around 1887, 88. So this is not the original kitchen to Senate House. It's actually a later addition onto it that the state put on. So when you're in there, basically, as I mentioned, the state, their philosophy back then was to make it look like the period you're interpreting. So they actually built what they thought looks like and does a 1777 kitchen. It just reminds me of a story when I worked at Herkimer Home, because it's so, there's very similar, although they were even more extensive at Herkimer Home with the restoration, tearing out the historic fabric. They basically gutted it and rebuilt it the way they thought it should look. So I'm sure if General Herkimer came back today, he probably wouldn't recognize the inside of the building. But my predecessor, well, while they were doing it, they had to rebuild the fireplace in the kitchen, the cooking fireplace. And unfortunately, they have to actually rebuilt it with modern bricks, so it doesn't look all that old. But they also thought back in the 60s that it would be nice if the fireplace also had a beehive oven with it, even though the original did not. So they built a beehive oven next to the fireplace that was very, very, very undersized for a beehive oven. My predecessor, I was talking to him, we were in the kitchen, and he was telling me a story of taking a gentleman around on a tour of Herkimer Home. And when they got to the kitchen, the gentleman immediately made a comment, "Well, that beehive oven is so small, you can't even bake a cookie in it." Well, my predecessor said, just to prove him wrong, he was able to bake a cookie in it. So some of these things weren't done quite to the standards that we would see today. Thanks to the Cooperstown Graduate Program for Museum Studies, that really kicked off the professionalization of historic sites and the museum profession. Today, we have programs all around the country, and it's really Cooperstown led the way in establishing that back in 1964. So we've come a long way when it comes to historic preservation. So basically, this area you see here, this is the kitchen, this is the caretaker's cottage, or well, caretaker's living space, was all added by New York State after they acquired it in 1887. Repairs were also made to the chimneys, and a wood shingle roof was also installed. I just want to mention one of Senate House's earliest advocates. His name was Judge Alfonso T. Clearwater. He was president of the Board of Trustees of the Senate House Association from 1887 to 1933. So he was there from the very beginning of state acquisition. Judge Clearwater fought to get things done for the benefit of Senate House and credits himself with convincing New York to purchase the Senate House. One of his attempts in trying to get lighting for the Senate House grounds, Judge Clearwater appealed to the American Gas Company, and he writes in a letter, "The city always has refused," and this is in 1916, "the city always has refused to light the grounds, claiming the state should do it. The state, in turn, thinks it is the duty of the city to do this, with result that the grounds are not lighted, and at night are the resort of desolate persons, and in the morning an interesting harvest of forgotten lingerie, beer bottles, and whiskey flaxes is garnered by the custodian. 100 years later, our grounds are completely lit, and we still have that same problem," as Judge Clearwater said. As he so eloquently put it, interesting harvest of lingerie, beer bottles, and whiskey flasks. We find them all the time on the property. There we go. Okay. However, the most dramatic changes to the Senate House occurred during the 1948 to 1962 restoration period under the New York State Architect's Office. And this shows, this is just a floor plan showing where they replaced windows and doors, and I'll actually read off a list of some of the things that they did during this, but this was the most active restoration period, 1948 to 1962. Before the restoration began, Miss Elizabeth Hollihan, a member of the American Institute of Decorators, was retained as a consultant for the Senate House restoration. Miss Hollihan recommended that the restoration be carried out with sensitivity to original building fabric. She recommended that the jambs of the window recesses should not be replaced. The floors should not be given a drastic sanding. The repainting should be sensitively undertaken, and the historic brick should not be sandblasted. She had warned the state architect not to fake the old in a historic house. She was actually a lady very much ahead of her time, because that's what we do now. We don't fake the old. But back then, the philosophy was completely different. Not heeding her advice, the state went ahead and made several changes to Senate House. Some of the changes that were made during this period include sandblasting of the west exterior brick wall, which she recommended against, replacing all existing window sash and glass, with the exception of the two quarter circle windows in room 208. They were replaced by modern sash and modern wavy glass. All existing shutters were removed and replaced by modern shutters. An exterior door at the rear of the Senate room was removed and replaced by a window. Various interior doors were installed, rehung, or permanently closed off. An early narrow stairway from the first to second floor in room 103 was removed. Wooden boxing was removed from the exposed second floor joists, and plaster on metal lath ceilings were installed. Some of the existing wood plank floor of the first floor rooms was heavily sanded with power equipment. Samples of paint from some of the rooms were investigated. However, no report analyzing the original paint colors or chemistry or the sequence of paint has been located. So basically, they did the opposite of what she was recommending. Even though she was an advisor for the restoration of the Senate House. So today, the Senate House is a mixture of 17th, 18th, 19th, and 20th century fabric. The Senate House today is open for tours to the public. We're open from mid-April through October, where visitors can learn about the history of the house and its historical importance in New York State history. But the Senate House State Historic Site is more than just the Senate House itself. We have several buildings on the site, and in 1927, in response to the 150th anniversary, or also known as the sesquicentennial, of the Revolution and the Burning of Kingston, a major undertaking got underway with the building of the Senate House Museum on property already owned by New York State. A bequest of $10,000 for the planned $100,000 building was left for this purpose by Judge Alton B. Parker, who had run for President of the United States on the Democratic ticket in 1904. His wife, Amelia, pictured next to him, for many years also actively sought additional funds from the state. Finally, on September 10, 1927, the cornerstone of the new museum was laid with Governor Alfred E. Smith among the attendees. After several delays, the museum was opened on Flag Day, June 14, 1930. Over the years, changes have been made to the interior of the museum. In the 1970s, in response to the upcoming bicentennial, the second floor of the museum was renovated. You see from this picture, this is the second floor. It consisted of many rooms. In the 1970s, for the bicentennial, the state knocked down the walls and made the second floor one big gallery that we have today. Today, the museum continues to welcome visitors from around the country and around the world, and is currently undergoing an extensive revamping of the galleries to offer visitors new, exciting, and state-of-the-art exhibits. You may have noticed when you hung up your coat, the exhibit that was in there, which we formerly called the Recollects Gallery, has been taken down, and we're working right now on a new permanent exhibit, up-to-date, modern, that's going to be featuring the old historic stockade area here in Kingston. So we're looking at that opening by the beginning of our season in 2016. In the meantime, what we're going to put in that space is we had a very successful temporary exhibit entitled With Malice Toward None, Ulster County and the Civil War. We had that over in the Lauren House, just as a one-year temporary exhibit. We're revamping that exhibit, and we're going to be moving it temporarily into that space for next season until the permanent exhibit is installed in that room. So as early as next season, you'll see changes here. You're seeing them now with the exhibit coming down, but you'll be seeing changes here in the museum, something, new things to look at. New things, new reasons to come to the museum. The museum is a great asset to the site, and we're hoping within the next 3 to 4 years have both the Recollects Gallery, formerly Recollects, and the space upstairs all occupying new and exciting exhibits. In 1968, New York State added to the Senate House site with the purchase of the Lauren House at 296 Fair Street. The Lauren House, built around 1872, is a classic example of Italianate architecture designed by Poughkeepsie architect John A. Wood for Dr. Robert Lauren, a Civil War surgeon and prominent Kingston physician. In 1924, William N. Connor purchased the Lauren House from descendants of Dr. Lauren and moved his business, the Connor Funeral Home, into the building. I believe this is the embalming room in there. In October 1968, the New York State Historic Trust purchased the Lauren House from Harry Barnhart and George Schroeder, then partners in the funeral home. They were allowed to continue their business in the building for 1 year. Today, the Lauren House houses the site's offices. The site's offices, collection storage, galleries for temporary exhibits, and is the location for the site's annual Christmas open house, sponsored by the Friends of Senate House each December. This is a photo of the Civil War exhibit that we had just recently over in the Lauren House. Lauren House has great gallery space over there for temporary exhibits. And we were just talking about what our next temporary exhibit's going to be over there in the Lauren House. So we're hoping to, hopefully, within a reasonable amount of time, have another temporary exhibit over there. But this exhibit will be temporarily moving to the museum to fill the space until the permanent exhibit is installed in the spring of 2016. Next to the Lauren House is the carriage barn that served to house the horse-drawn vehicles for Dr. Lauren and his family, and later the hearses for the Connor Funeral Home. Today, this building is known as the Yorker Barn and houses the site's maintenance equipment. There is also a small shed that's located on the property and is used for additional storage. Across the street from the site on Clinton Ave is the Abraham Maston House that is also part of the site. This is a two-story federal style building built probably, I would estimate, in the early 1820s. Being federal style, the popularity time period for that roughly ran from 1790 to 1830. You didn't really see federal prior to 1790, and you really didn't see a lot of it being built after 1830, because then the main architectural style became Greek Revival. So I would estimate this is early 1800s because of its architectural style. This building most recently served as the City of Kingston Uptown Visitor Center. Also, part of the site and adjacent to the Maston House is a parking lot which formerly housed a gas station. So that is now the parking lot, our second parking lot on the other side of Clinton Ave. Also, part of the Senate House site, the property, is this strip of land you see here along Fair Street alongside of the Artel building. The Artel building is not part of our property, it's privately owned, but we do own this strip of land. And along this strip of land, along Fair Street, were businesses. And you can see this is a barbershop, I think, yeah, barbershop. But this back here is the Artel building. So all along Fair Street, along where the Artel building is, where there's that strip of land, did house businesses. In fact, every now and then, because the foundations are still there, it causes the ground to sink, and we have to bring additional fill in, which we just did either last spring or early summer, I think it was, to fill that in. So we discourage people from going into that area, but that's also part of the property itself. Today, Senate House State Historic Site includes six buildings, two parking lots, and 3.1 acres of land. The grounds are open to the public daily from dawn to dusk and is host to many activities throughout the year. From special events, private functions, picnicking, the Senate House serves as an important historic and recreational spot in the heart of Uptown Kingston. This shows the Lauren House. They're all marked museum building, Senate House. This is the area where the shed is. Over here would be the carriage barn. They're just not darkened in like the other ones. So you can see what started out as just the Senate House has evolved over the years into a large complex here in the middle of Uptown Kingston. And we offer a variety of different activities over here. It's an extremely popular place in the nice weather for people to come and have their lunches, picnic here. We also rent the grounds out for special events, and we have a number of special events that we sponsor during our operating season, and even after with the upcoming Christmas that we have. Just to mention the Christmas, I would like to end by inviting everyone to join us for our upcoming special event, a Festival of Lights on Friday evening, December 5th from 5 to 8 p.m. in conjunction with the Uptown Kingston Snowflake Festival. There will be a lot going on here at the Senate House site and in Uptown in general. That evening, enjoy visiting the Lauren House, elegantly decorated for the holiday season. Stroll the grounds and marvel at the extensive light displays. Take a leisurely horse and wagon ride through Uptown Kingston. Participate in the tree lighting ceremony. Enjoy the sounds of Christmas carolers. Enjoy chestnuts roasting over an open fire. And for the young, visit with Santa in front of the Senate House Museum. The event is free. Everything I just mentioned is free, even the horse and wagon rides around Uptown. That's sponsored by the Friends of Senate House, pay for that. and enjoy the upcoming holiday season at Senate House State Historic Site. So thank you for your time.
Do we have any questions for Tom and Deana? And if we do, I'll just ask. I'll bring the microphone over to you.
How many senators were at the Senate House when they met?
Tom and Deana?
I'm sorry.
The question is, how many senators were appeared at the Senate House when they met here?
There were actually 25 men elected to the Senate for the month that they met here, depending on what day you look at, anywhere between 13 and 17. So they always had a quorum, and they never had all 24.
Any other questions?
I was wondering about the period when the roof was copper and why it was changed back to wood.
I think the copper roof was taken off in 1975, I believe. And I think they took it off because they wanted it to be more accurate as to what was here in 1777 and put the shingle roof on. We had a new shingle roof put on, I'd say maybe 10 years ago. It's cedar. And on a humid day in the summertime, it smells like a birdcage over in the Senate House.
Yes. Did they ever do any archaeological digs?
Yes, they have done some rather extensive archaeological digs. They found a lot of building material, a lot of chips of limestone, pantile roof bits, a lot of ceramics. Some of the ceramics they found were really interesting. They found evidence of a very common, everyday type of ceramics, and it just moved up the ladder to the finer things. So there were some fine things. So the Van Gaspeek, Ten Broeck occupation of the house, they were probably doing fairly well financially because they could afford to import the finer ceramics. And they found evidence of some of the food that was eaten, bones and shells and things like that. A lot of pork, a lot of fish. So, just a few feet underneath.
Any other questions?
The Van Gaspeek, I had come across that name when I was doing my report on Vanderlyn.
Mm-hmm.
That Van Gaspeek was a friend of the portrait was done of who was Vanderlyn's sponsor?
Aaron Burr.
Aaron Burr.
Yes.
Right. So that was Peter?
Peter Van Gaspeek was a friend of Aaron Burr, yes.
And he's the one that introduced the painting of Aaron Burr
Yes, that's exactly right. Yes.
Okay, great. Yep. Thank you.
We have a wonderful collection of letters that Aaron Burr has written, politics, writing to Peter, writing in code. We do have a one letter that's kind of in code. So, yeah, we do have some Aaron Burr letters in our archives.
Do we have any other questions? No? Well, Deana and Tom, thank you.
Thank you.
And we really need to thank Deana and Tom and everybody here at the Senate House for everything that they've done for us. As I said in the beginning, we would not be here today if it were not for them. They opened up the Senate House to us from day one. When the season is over and they're closed, they open up. They staff it. They put out everything for us each and every day. So again, we want to thank you for making this possible. And I'll tell you, they have been absolutely wonderful from the start. It really has been a special partnership. But when you talk about the Senate House, it's almost a 6 degrees of separation. When you look back at the history of Kingston, almost everything is tied in somehow with the Senate House. When Deana's talking about Thomas Chambers, who was actually our first subject of Kingston's buried treasures, and he's considered the first settler of Kingston. Wessel Ten Broeck, the builder of the Senate House, married Thomas Chambers' widow, who was of Van Gaspeek. You have Frederick Westbrook, who was one of the last residents of the Senate House, had written, as Deana said, a little history on the courthouse, I mean on the Senate House, and he maintains that John Jay stayed in the Senate House while he was here for the Constitutional Convention and may well have wrote at least portions of the New York State Constitution while residing in the Senate House. Now, in all fairness, I've never seen that anywhere else besides Frederick Westbrook's statements, but it's interesting to think if that could have happened. Sarah Van Gasbeck's sister married Dumont and became part of the Dumont family. John Dumont was the owner of Sojourner Truth at the time that she ran away. So when you look at certainly the, our subjects that we've featured here in this lecture series, very few are not affiliated in some way or another with the Senate House. And again, I was just thinking on the way over here, how many of our subjects that we've had have an affiliation with it? And these are a few. Frederick Westbrook was related to Cornelius Westbrook, who was the Lieutenant Colonel of the Ulster 120th, took over the actual day-to-day command when George Sharp left to form the Bureau of Military Information. I believe he was part of the 20th, the original 20th, on their first 90-day term of service under George Pratt. Alton Parker, as we see, I thought that he was one of the few who did not have an affiliation with the Senate House. He did. John Vanderlyn. You know, it's just an amazing place. It's always been an amazing place, and thanks to Tom and Deana and everybody who works here, it always will be an amazing place. So again, we thank you for doing the presentation tonight, and we again thank you for everything you do to make this possible. I do want to tell everybody about our upcoming talks. Next month, December 12th, we're actually, ordinarily we're the third Friday of the month. Next month, due to the holidays, we are actually going to be the second Friday. Anna Brett, who I'm sure many people have are familiar with. Anna has been a lifetime Kingston educator. She's a member of the SUNY Ulster Trustee Board. She is going to speak about the 100th anniversary of Kingston High School. Their subject of that is Educating Kingston, the Spark That Ignited a Future. We've had quite a history with the Kingston High School, going beyond what we've discussed in the past about the Academy building. I found that there were four generals, four U.S. Army generals that have graduated from Kingston High School, which is pretty amazing, pretty amazing. So that will be our December feature, and on January 16, 2015, the subject will be John Jay, Founding Neighbor. And our presenter is going to be Professor Ray Raymond, and Ray, he's a director of the Institute of Constitutional Studies at SUNY Ulster. He has taught at West Point, Annapolis. They run a lecture series at SUNY Ulster through the Constitutional Studies program that is absolutely amazing. I've seen many people here at that. And I'll tell you, they have wonderful speakers and subjects, but I go because Ray Raymond is so entertaining. He's the MC, and he is as entertaining as any of the speakers they've had. So he's going to be here with us in January. So we hope that everybody can join us next month and as we continue. And we also would like to thank all the people, again, besides for Tom and Deana and everybody who's part of the Senate House, who make this possible. This is really a community effort. This has been a wonderful series, and it's because of all the people that you see up here and all of you. Again, we appreciate your support, we appreciate your love of history, and again, we'll keep going as long as you are willing to participate and be part of it. So we thank you, we hope you have a good weekend, and we hope to see you in December. Oh, one other aside, and I forgot, Deana referred to the Minister of France who resided for a period of time right at the Senate House. That was John Armstrong, and John Armstrong was part of the Newburgh Conspiracy during the Revolution when George Washington and the Continental Army were at Newburgh and New Windsor at the Cantonment. Everybody's probably heard of the famous speech that George Washington gave when there was really a mutiny in effect. The soldiers hadn't been paid in so long. They'd given up any faith that, that the Congress would come to their aid. And they basically stated that they didn't feel that the soldiers should pay any attention to Congress anymore, that they should go their own way, and that they implied to George Washington that he should maybe take up the mantle of power and act as king. They wrote there was a very famous series of letters to that effect. They were written anonymously, and George Washington came to what the building that they called the Temple to address the officers and the men of the Continental Army, and that was where, when he started reading his speech, he put on his glasses and said, if you'll excuse me, I have gone not only gray, but blind in the service of my country. Said that the officers and the soldiers who were there all broke down in tears, the mutiny dissolved, and everybody agreed with George Washington that they would continue to support the government and allow the United States government to actually come into existence. John Armstrong was the writer of the letters that created the mutiny. He was very circumspect about that after, and I believe that it was John Tappan, who lived at the DAR house, who kind of outed him for this, said that he was the writer of it, and the two began a very angry missive through the papers. They were political opposites, but John Armstrong was the writer of that. He was the formulator of the Newburgh Mutiny. So he became Minister of France under Thomas Jefferson and rented out and lived for a number of years the Senate House, while his children went to the Academy building. So just another tie in not only our local history, but in our national history, where the Senate House has played such an important role. So sorry to pull everybody back. Again, have a good weekend.